when you're considering your favorite noirs, what's more important to you, the technical achievements of a film or how a movie makes you feel?
Without question, how a movie makes you feel. I mean, that's the reason we watch films, right? So as much as you can appreciate the cinematography and the art direction and all this stuff, it's how, you know, the emotional impact that you get from it. Because when I watch a movie, what I want is to experience an emotion that was completely unexpected, or this is unusual because it's a different type of emotional reaction to the film. So yeah, that's an easy one. It's all about the emotion.
Yeah, I know a lot of film scholars struggle with that because you, from your heart, can love a movie emotionally. You can have an emotional attachment to it, like I do with Dead Reckoning. But on the other hand, there are a lot of people that say, no, you should love the Citizen Kanes, mm-hmm. the Lady from Shanghai's, all of those movies. Not to quote to Orson Welles, but I mean, there you go. He's the epitome of cinematography at its best, but it's hard sometimes to weigh those two to try to find a nice balance as well.
No, I understand exactly what you're saying, and I think it's a really vital discussion to have, because a lot of times I think the quote-unquote film scholars dismiss movies that play on people's emotions because it's manipulative or something, or oh, that's just a crowd pleaser movie or something, and they tend to not understand how much technique and sophistication goes into pleasing a crowd, right? I mean, here at the TCM Festival, the opening night film, When Harry Met Sally, you know, I hadn't seen that again since it opened. And, you know, that's a crowd pleaser movie. But it's a very well-made, sophisticated movie. And Meg Ryan is the glue that holds that movie together. She gives a fantastic performance that will never be recognized because nobody recognizes comedy. You know, she'll never be nominated for an Oscar or anything for that, but she is sensational in that movie, as good as any, you know, be absolutely devastatingly heartbroken and crying your eyes out, and don't lose your comedic timing. I mean, that's
exactly
that stuff's hard to do in the service of a story that everybody can relate to, you know? So I get exactly where you're coming from. And I mean, I love Citizen Kane, you know? I love Vertigo. You know, what is the emotional impact of Vertigo? You know, it's like a weird impact, like, oh my God, you know, it's like an elevator drop in your chest or something, which is not what everybody wants to feel. But that is a spellbinding film, not something that is a crowd pleaser by any stretch of the imagination. Anyway, it's great that we can experience all of these different reactions to movies, and none of them are right. They're yours, right?
So another thing that I was wondering about in doing my research, I found out the most insane thing. As a fan of yours, I didn't know this until yesterday. You were nominated for a Student Academy Award in 1979. Is that true?
Yes, yes, that is
true. Tell me a little bit about that.
Now people want to see the movie, and I made it so long ago that I don't think I ever had it transferred to digital or anything, so you're gonna have to find a 16 millimeter projector if you want to see it. It was, of course, a tribute to Raymond Chandler. It was my very condensed, poeticized version of a Philip Marlowe story. It was like 13 and a half minutes long or something. Of course, now I realize that it was too long. You know, because I made this before the advent of music videos or anything, and it's like, man, people could have gotten this in half the time that it took me to tell it.
So it was an adaptation?
No, it was my adaptation of all of his stories. That's what I mean by it's poetic. It's simulating the flow of a detective story without any coherence in the narrative. It's like
The Big Sleep.
Exactly. It's like, well, there's always this moment where he first finds the body, and then there's always this moment where the femme fatale appears, and there's always this, you know, where he gets hit over the head. And it was just like all these moments kind of strung together to simulate a story with absolutely no explanation given as to what the hell was going on. Just like The Big Sleep. So, yes, it was one of five finalists for the Student Academy Awards. It did not win. But it's great just to be nominated.
I'm sure you get this one a lot, but do you really actually mix drinks on set? And if so, what's your preferred drink of choice while you're filming?
The most pertinent question. Yes. Yes, the answer is yes. I mean, if it's something that we're doing and there's gonna be a million takes, we think there's, like in the promos, because you know, I can't stand the people that produce these promos. They're just slave drivers, and it's, oh my God, if they weren't geniuses, I would rebel. But then when I know there's gonna be multiple takes, it's not really booze. But a lot of times we do.
It seems ridiculous to have such a beautiful setup and not actually mix anything and drink anything.
Yes, I can't say that the bar is always fully stocked, but there's usually something back there that will get the job done.
And what do you drink usually when you're doing that?
Well, I made a thing where I showed how to make the perfect martini.
I did see that.
Or Eddie's version of the perfect martini, not a perfect martini, which is a mix of sweetened dry vermouth, but it's a martini. I drink martinis.